accession to the throne, Charles became the longest reigning heir apparent in British history. Due to his long 70-year apprenticeship, he is now the most experienced and senior new monarch. Charles has lived through the long reign of his mother and saw 15 British prime ministers and 14 American presidents come and go. So what sort of king could we hope to see after the magnificent era-defining reign of Queen Elizabeth II? And how would a prince who is used to having his voice heard adjust to the monarchy's policy of non-interference? Join me now as we look at the days and years ahead for King Charles III. And please like the video and consider subscribing for more historical stories. In his new role as monarch, Prince Charles will no longer be able to use his passport or driver's license or voice his ideas openly. Being a monarch is more important than being a person. It's now a case of different roles and distinct norms. The public won't want a campaigning monarch, therefore the king will have to alter his approach. King Charles is fully aware of the necessity of lowering his level of public openness. In a 2018 interview with the BBC, he added, "I'm not so naive. I do realise it's a separate exercise being sovereign. It's ridiculous to think that I'm going to keep doing things the same old way." When a new king or queen ascends to the throne, the royal portrait on the currency is reversed, meaning the emphasis of Charles's rule will shift as well. So will the new king reach out to a multicultural, multi-faith Britain? To fulfil his role as a unifying figure, he will need to make more overt efforts to reach out and build relationships with traditionally marginalised communities and groups. There will be more Shakespeare and fewer horse races, and much more royal support of the arts, music and culture has been suggested. However, it is thought that the new king will not, or at least not plan, to completely withdraw from his work on topics such as climate change and organic farming. It is hard to conceive that he will give everything up so close to his heart on the day he becomes sovereign. Recent reports have indicated that the king favours a more minimalistic monarchy. It's likely to mean a refocusing of the core group of working royals, the king and his consort, his son Prince William, and daughter-in-law Catherine. However, that continuity and stability will be the main themes of the coming reign. It should be noted that anything drastic in terms of changes will be from a position of extreme caution. We've tended to consider the Queen a constant in national life, but apart from her, he's been there longer than anybody else in public life, longer than any politician. King Charles has been strengthened by being proven right on subjects like his warnings about climate change, although once mocked, many now see him as an Attenborough-esque figure. One example of Charles's ability to be a success will be due to his prominence on the international stage, and one that will serve him well as king. But what sort of person will the new king be? Those who know him best say that at heart, he's a quiet and shy introvert, someone with a sensitive soul, to use another expression. The child who complained about being bullied and ignored at school has left his mark. He described the bullying he experienced at the school dorm in a letter home. "They throw slippers all night long, or hit me with pillows, or rush across the room and hit me as hard as they can." But his now Queen Consort wife Camilla said of him, "He wants things done by yesterday, and that's how he gets things done." In a TV appearance for his 70th birthday, she revealed that Charles has a more playful side than the public sees. Camilla stated, "He goes down on his knees and plays with the children, reading Harry Potter to them and performing the voices. And they regard him as a very serious person, which he is, but I would like to see people see the lighter side of him." Charles has become a very personable public figure, winning over his listeners with a few jokes, even about himself. There was never any coldness or standoffishness in his demeanour as Prince of Wales, and it's possible that won't change now he becomes monarch. The king seems to be in good health and spirits for a man now in his 70s. On the Prince's Teaching Institute, Charles has been described as a tirelessly active, motivated character, a bundle of energy taking on a massive job. You can see that he cares deeply about the future generation in much of his work. Before his monarchy begins, the prince promoted innovation and transformation through his philanthropic activity, which included safeguarding cultural traditions. The new king's personality seems to unite the seemingly opposing concepts of wanting change and wishing to conserve. You might call him a Tweedy radical. He occasionally takes on the appearance of a healthy landowner straight out of an 18th century painting. At other times, he comes across as a frustrated reformer, angry over the marginalisation of some groups. Since 2007, when he was involved in establishing the British Asian Trust, Charles has been a humanitarian at heart, a man who has been a misunderstanding. However, he does care. Prince Harry has described his father as someone who eats dinner at an absurdly late hour before going to bed, with his notes left open on the desk. Charles Philip Arthur George was born on the 14th of November 1948 at Buckingham Palace. The BBC did not report that the Queen had given birth to a son, but that his mother had safely delivered a prince. He was declared the heir apparent 4 years later. In an interview in 2005, Charles said, "I find myself born into this specific position. I'm resolved to make the most of it and to do anything I can to help." With the money he received for leaving the Royal Navy, the Prince of Wales formed his flagship charity, the Prince's Trust, in 1976. It has helped approximately 900,000 disadvantaged young people from some of the poorest sections of the country and given him an insight into a range of social challenges. The Home Office didn't think it was at all a good concept, and it was rather difficult to get it off the ground, Charles said in a BBC interview in 2018. His efforts have been criticised for allegedly intervening in politics and drawing attention to the so-called Black Spider memos. Taking their name from Charles's spidery handwriting, these were private letters from Charles to government ministers from 2004 onwards. The letters questioned the government's attitude on matters such as farming, urban planning, architecture, education, and even safeguarding the Patagonian toothfish. An ex-cabinet minister, who was the target of Charles's lobbying, says he didn't feel any significant pressure, but remembers the new king as someone with firm convictions. He thought he came in with his mind all made up on what he believed and was unwilling to hear out alternative points of view. He would make his interventions and you'd get letters. He didn't assert, he didn't push, and he wasn't discourteous. In an interview in 2006, Charles reflected on the allegations of interference, saying, "If it's meddling, I'm proud of it." However, he did concede that he was in a no-win situation. He remarked, "If you do nothing, they'll complain about that. And if you try to get stuck in and do anything to help, they'll complain about that too." He avoided party politics, and he added in a subsequent interview, but felt compelled to speak up about things like the conditions in which people were living. Charles has surprised many with his single-mindedness and willingness to risk treading on official toes. This is a man who, if chose, could fritter away his life on idleness and self-indulgence, yet he keeps coming back to the same subject. How to broaden the horizons of the young, especially the alienated, the unlucky, and the malevolent. To what extent will the populace welcome King Charles as he assumes the throne? Charles has declared if people don't want it, he won't have it. Thus, it's important to consider public opinion when maintaining the monarchy. YouGov polling from December of 2021 shows that about two-thirds of the population has a favourable opinion of him. However, public support has never been as high for him as it was for either Queen Elizabeth II or Prince William. So he has a sizeable audience to win over. In particular, his standing with the younger generation has declined, and it could be due to the cynical depictions of Charles in media depicting his marriage to Diana, Princess of Wales. What's been particularly intriguing over the last 5 years is how huge Diana continues to loom as a narrative. Many now believe that efforts have been made to alter the public's opinion of Charles as he has grown closer to the throne. Despite his history of being mocked on comedic shows like Spitting Image, he's now seen as a more respectable character and even a sage, with important things to say about the environment. A As head of the royal family, Charles will also have to deal with the worldwide interest in Prince Harry and his wife Meghan, the Duchess of Sussex, and their life together. It's not his domain when stories about the royal family start to blend in with the operatic soap lives of famous people. After the compensation accord that followed the sexual assault charges of Virginia Giuffre, King Charles faced another complex family consideration, such as the future position of Prince Andrew or lack thereof. Aside from the United Kingdom, redefining a more contemporary relationship with the Commonwealth will be a significant task. How can the organisation's new leader trips to Commonwealth nations avoid reopening old wounds related to colonialism and slavery? As well as the United Kingdom, King Charles is now a monarch of 14 other countries. Even if they remain members of the Commonwealth, some of these countries may wish to transition to a republic. King Charles has indicated he is open to mature discussions about this possibility. Several critical decisions have already been made to make his reign much more manageable. His mother must have intervened and suggested that Camilla be addressed as Queen Consort instead of Princess, and he must have been overjoyed. Camilla will be critical in support as he enters one of the highest prominent roles in the world at an age when most people would have retired. Yet he has been preparing for this moment all his life, in all its terrifying solemnity. But now it's finally King Charles's turn to rule.